The Unrest Cure by Saki, narrated by Trevor O'Hare. On the rack in the railway carriage, immediately opposite Clovis, was a solidly wrought traveling bag, with a carefully written label, on which was inscribed J.P. Huddle, The Warren, Tilfield, near Slowborough. Immediately below the rack sat the human embodiment of the label, a solid, sedate individual, sedately dressed, sedately conversational. Even without his conversation, which was addressed to a friend seated by his side, and touched chiefly on such topics as the backwardness of Roman hyacinths and the prevalence of measles at the rectory, one could have gauged fairly accurately the temperament and mental outlook of the traveling bag's owner. But he seemed unwilling to leave anything to the imagination of a casual observer, and his talk grew presently personal and introspective. "I don't know how it is," he told his friend. "I'm not much over 40, but I seem to have settled down into a deep groove of elderly middle age. My sister shows the same tendency. We like everything to be exactly in its accustomed place. We like things to happen exactly at their appointed times. We like everything to be usual, orderly, punctual, methodical, to a hair's breadth, to the minute. It distresses and upsets us if it is not so. For instance, to take a very trifling matter, a thrush has built its nest year after year in the catkin tree on the lawn. This year, for no obvious reason, it is building in the ivy on the garden wall. We've said very little about it, but I think we both feel that the change is unnecessary and just a little irritating." "Perhaps," said the friend, "it is a different thrush." "We have suspected that," said J.P. Huddle, "and I think it gives us even more cause for annoyance. We don't feel that we want a change of thrush at our time of life, and yet, as I have said, we've scarcely reached an age when these things should make themselves seriously felt." "What you want," said the friend, "is an unrest cure." "An unrest cure? I've never heard of such a thing." "You've heard of rest cures for people who've broken down under stress of too much worry and strenuous living. Well, you're suffering from overmuch repose and placidity, and you need the opposite kind of treatment." "But where would one go for such a thing?" "Well, you might stand as an orange candidate for Kilkenny, or do a course of district visiting in one of the Apache quarters of Paris, or give lectures in Berlin to prove that most of Wagner's music was written by Gambetta, and there's always the interior of Morocco to travel in. But, to be really effective, the unrest cure ought to be tried in the home. How you would do it, I haven't the faintest idea." It was at this point in the conversation that Clovis became galvanized into alert attention. After all, his 2 days' visit to an elderly relative at Slowborough did not promise much excitement. Before the train had stopped, he had decorated his sinister shirt cuff with the inscription, J.P. Huddle, The Warren, Tilfield, near Slowborough. 2 mornings later, Mr. Huddle broke in on his sister's privacy as she sat reading Country Life in the morning room. It was her day and hour and place for reading Country Life, and the intrusion was absolutely irregular. But he bore in his hand a telegram, and in that household, telegrams were recognized as happening by the hand of God. This particular telegram partook of the nature of a thunderbolt. Bishop examining confirmation class in neighborhood, unable stay rectory on account measles invokes your hospitality, sending secretary arrange. "I scarcely know the bishop. I've only spoken to him once," exclaimed J.P. Huddle, with the exculpating air of one who realizes too late the indiscretion of speaking to strange bishops. Miss Huddle was the first to rally. She disliked thunderbolts as fervently as her brother did, but the womanly instinct in her told her that the thunderbolts must be fed. "We can curry the cold duck," she said. It was not the appointed day for curry, but the little orange envelope involved a certain departure from rule and custom. Her brother said nothing, but his eyes thanked her for being brave. "A young gentleman to see you," announced the parlor maid. "The secretary," murmured the Huddles in unison. They instantly stiffened into a demeanor which proclaimed that, though they held all strangers to be guilty, they were willing to hear anything they might have to say in their defense. The young gentleman, who came into the room with a certain elegant haughtiness, was not at all Huddle's idea of a bishop's secretary. He had not supposed that the episcopal establishment could have afforded such an expensively upholstered article when there were so many other claims on its resources. The face was fleetingly familiar. If he had bestowed more attention on the fellow traveler sitting opposite him in the railway carriage 2 days before, he might have recognized Clovis in his present visitor. "You are the bishop's secretary?" asked Huddle, becoming consciously deferential. "His confidential secretary," answered Clovis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.